Last week, we talked about demons and spiritual warfare, and what does the Bible have to say with all that, and we did a message called Under the Influence. Tonight, same title, Under the Influence. This time, we're talking about substance abuse, drugs, alcohol, all that kind of stuff, and tonight's going to be a little bit different, so I want to let you know how we're going to end before we get there, and then we'll get there together. I'm going to do a time of Q&A at the end, because I realize this is a message. Sometimes when you preach a message, I'm not going to necessarily always be able to scratch where it itches. You know, sometimes you guys might have a very specific question, but I'm going to teach in broad terms and just kind of teach what the Bible says in broad terms about it. And then if you have questions at the end, you guys can submit those. And so at any point tonight, you can submit those questions. Just go to capitalvhm.com, capitalvhm.com, and you can submit as many questions as you want. And then at the end, we'll have some time to kind of go through some of that stuff. And so right off the top, I want to let you guys know that this is part of my past, okay? And so I'm not just coming, just kind of, you know, someone who's never experienced drugs or alcohol, and I'm just like telling you what the Bible says. And in fact, what was really hard preparing for this message is it's really hard to find like normal Christians teaching about this kind of stuff. There was no shortage of weirdos out there, like no shortage, like it was crazy. And just side note, if you're ever like looking for what the Bible has to say about stuff and you start Googling stuff, like what does the Bible say about drugs, if the website or the video looks weird, it probably is, okay? Like you can't necessarily trust those people. And so I had to do a sift through a lot of that craziness, but I learned a lot and it was really cool. So here's the deal. I know that some of you guys, this is a struggle for you guys. Some of you guys are messing with drugs and messing with alcohol, doing different things, you know, maybe addicted to a prescription medication, something like that. And we're going to talk about that and how you guys can get freedom from that. Some of you guys, maybe not, maybe you know a friend who is, you know, all that kind of stuff. I'm asking for a friend kind of thing tonight. But I want you to have, I want you to know your no, okay? I want you to know why you would say no to some of that stuff, because well, I guess I'll just jump into it. The reason I got hooked on drugs is because I didn't have a good no. And that sounds like the dumbest reason on the planet, but it's the truth. First exposure, well, one, last week we talked about like opening the doors to different things. I was open to the doors of drugs and alcohol my whole life. My dad was an alcoholic. Liquor was always there. Some of my earliest memories were going to the liquor store with him. I had cable in my room. You guys don't know what cable TV is, but like my parents, man, censorship was just not a thing of parents in the 80s and 90s. Like I had full cable, premium channels, and I learned a lot of bad stuff at an early age. I was what you would call a good kid. I went to a Christian school, like a tiny little, like my parents are afraid of the world, so I'm going to put them in a small private school, Christian school, okay? And the first experience I had of drinking was New Year's Eve, sixth grade. And I was at my friend's house, and no parents were home, which was like the start of a brilliant night. And we snuck into his parents' liquor cabinet and played swig, swig, pass with a bottle of whiskey. And it did not end well, okay? And I'm here to tell you, like, it is the grace of God that I am still here being able to talk to you guys in full sentences, because I should be dead or brain dead or all of the above 10 times over. Man, it was bad news. Puked my brains out, and that was middle school. Fast forward a little bit to my sophomore year of high school. I'm in a car with some friends. We had just left this like music festival thing in our hometown, and we're driving down the road, and he starts like doing stuff with a soda can. And I'm like, what are you doing? Are you into like aluminum origami? Like, what's going on? And he's like, we're about to smoke it up. And I'm like, we are. And like, I know it sounds so dumb, but I was just too nervous to say no. Like, it wasn't that I wanted to do it. It wasn't like I was like, yes, I'm about to get high for the first time. It wasn't like, can't wait to go down this road. I was nervous. I was scared. And it really just came down to, I didn't want to get into this confrontation of like telling them no. And I had always grown up knowing the drugs are bad. Like I'm an 80s, 90s child. Like we grew up on the commercial. There used to be this commercial that a guy would be in a kitchen and he would say, this is your brain. And then he would scramble eggs and he would say, this is your brain on drugs. Any questions? And I was like, yeah, I got lots of questions. My brain is not an egg. Like this makes no sense. But I knew it was wrong. I didn't want to do it, but there I was. Smoked weed for the first time, sophomore year of high school. And over the next couple years, I had become this like monster that I didn't even recognize. I was completely addicted to drugs. That, you know, marijuana for me was the gateway drug. Went on to heavier stuff. I don't want to get into the details of that because it's not really about glorify. I don't want to like impress you with like how jacked up I was. But it was messed up. It cost me jobs. It cost me lots of money to cover legal fees to get me out of trouble. Rehab centers, you know, waking up in hospitals, not knowing what happened the night before, losing friends, you know, doing drugs by myself. Like, the moment where my friend stepped into my life that eventually led me to Jesus, I was at a crossroads to where, like, I was actually thinking about, like, that as my future. Like, I can make tons of money, have the time of my life, like just go crazy. Meanwhile, knowing like my life's a wreck, I'm depressed, I'm angry, I'm fearful, but I don't care because every time I get high, it shuts that out for a few minutes. But it was getting harder and harder to keep that up. And after I got saved, God kind of halfway healed me. Okay, so I want to let you know the end of the process. Prayed a prayer at an altar, you know, got saved at fall retreat. You guys have heard that part of the story. And like instantly, like the desires, the addictions to drugs and alcohol just like gone, which was great. But he didn't take away all of it. I had a chemical dependency. I was still hooked on cigarettes and nicotine. Like I would get the shakes, and I can't tell you how many times I would like buy a pack of cigarettes, smoke one cigarette, be like, I'm done, Jesus, I'm sorry, throw away the other 19 cigarettes and the lighter, and then by the end of that day, going back to the gas station, getting another pack of cigarettes, like just blowing all these monies, trying to break this addiction, and it was really, really hard to do. And so I want to tell you that because sometimes God will deliver you. Sometimes he's going to teach you discipline, and he wants you to discipline your way out of it. He wants to teach you spiritual principles to help build discipline in your life. And wherever you are in that, I hope that God gives you freedom tonight. I hope he gives you determination to break some of these habits. And so here's the deal. I'm going to be talking about addiction, but you can kind of fill in the blanks for your own scenario. Maybe it's not, you know, a substance. Maybe it's a person. Maybe you're hooked on your boyfriend or girlfriend. Like they consume your life, and that's all you can think about. Maybe for real, like it's video games. You're like, I'm hooked on video games. Like it was hard to break off the video game and be here tonight. And all I'm thinking about is the game that I left on pause. Like that's all I want to do. Maybe it's sports. Maybe it's music. Maybe it's success. Maybe it's lust. Like anything that consumes you. We're going to talk about what that can do to us and how we can kind of break free from that. Yeah, I'm just going to get into it. Here's what I'm going to do in the next little bit of this. I'm just going to tell you what the Bible says, okay? Not really going to like preach it or apologize for it or overly explain it. This is the part where you're going to be like, I don't want to do drugs. And now I've got some ammunition as to why I don't want to do drugs, okay? You guys know this. Well, maybe you didn't. The Bible is not written in English. I don't know if you didn't know that. Original language is like Greek or Hebrew, and those languages were much more expressive. For instance, like we have one word, love, and that's just like universal. I love my shoes. I love my parents. I love my dog. I love Taco Bell. Like I love everything, right? They had different words of love that meant different things. They had love for like intimate, like spouse love. They had brotherly love. They had like, you know, sacrificial love, like all these different words. We just have one. And so there's one word that's in the Bible that we've kind of translated into like a 300-year-old word that, see, drugs, don't do drugs, they mess with your brain. It's like a 300-year-old word that doesn't really translate to today's language. And we read it, and there's still like some context to it, but it's not really what they're talking about. The word for it is pharmakia. Pharmakia. Can you just say that? Now you know Greek. Pharmakia. It's where we get our word for pharmacy, pharmacist, pharmaceutical. It comes from this root word, pharmakia. And this is what it means. It's the use or the administering of drugs. It means, which like, you're like, oh, that's not bad. That's like doctors and stuff. Next definition is poisoning. Next definition is sorcery, witchcraft, or magical arts, often found in connection with idol worship. This is like the pharmakia, the word in the Bible. When they talk about this, they're talking about someone who uses or deals drugs, normally in context with idol worship. And you're like, well, that's cool. I don't worship idols. Yes, we do all the time. The celebrities we model our life after, those are idols. An idol is anything you give your energy to or draw your energy from. That's an idol in your life. An idol can be anything. So anytime we use a substance in the context of our idols and heroes, that's sorcery, that's witchcraft, that's drug using, that's pharmakia. So let me kind of highlight some of the verses that talk about this in the New Testament. And again, I'm just gonna read them and kind of give them in context, because you've probably glanced over these verses before, and you hear witchcraft and you're like, I'm not a witch, I'm good. But just keep in touch. Every time you see sorcery, witchcraft, it means using or dealing drugs. It basically meaning anytime you're using a substance to be in a different state of mind. Pharmakia. Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 through 21, this is what it says. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. And this is one of those ones we like to use to judge other evil sinners that are much worse than us. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, pharmakia, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, rage, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. Okay, so what in the list of all of that other stuff, it's saying people that are into pharmakia are not going to inherit the kingdom of God. Fast forward to the Revelation. Revelation is the last book of the Bible. It kind of foretells the end of the world and how it's all going to lay out. And so in order, I'm going to read three different verses from Revelation, starting in chapter 9. In verse 21, he's basically talking to all these different churches, and he's laying out what they've done, what they're going to do, what they do well, and what their sin is, and how that plays out. And so the first verse says, they did not repent of their murders or their pharmakia, sorceries, or their sexual immorality or their thefts. And so it was saying in the end days, this is what's going on in society, okay? They're murdering, they're stealing, they're hooked on drugs. It very much like 2019, right? And it says as much as they tried to, as much as God tried to get their attention, they refused to repent of these actions because they saw nothing wrong with it. They're like, we're fine. These are harmless things that we're doing. Then it goes on, Revelation 18. It says, your merchants were the greatest in the world, and you deceived the nation with your sorceries. In other words, your trade system, your economy was really strong, but it was strong because you destroyed people by dealing drugs. Isn't it interesting? Again, pharmakia, where we get pharmaceutical, and if you look at the pharmaceutical industry, it's a multi-billion dollar industry dealing drugs to other nations when they could charge pennies on the dollar, but they don't, because they can keep us enslaved with the pharmaceuticals. And then at the very end, this is what goes on, this is what happens to them, Revelation 21. But the cowards, the unbelievers, the corrupt, the murderers, the immoral, the sorcerers, the pharmakiers, the drug users, the drug dealers, the idol worshipers, and all liars, their fate is in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. That's code language for hell, and this is the second death. So it says, after all of this, he's going to separate people from people that knew God and God knew them, and people that didn't. And the people that knew God, he's going to lay out all your deeds, everything you did, everything you're supposed to do, every action, every thought. God's going to lay it all out before you, and he's going to judge you, Christians, according to the works you did. That's what the Bible says. Then he goes to the other ones, and he looks at them, and he looks at their deeds. And anyone that did not know God gets thrown into the lake of fire, into hell, eternal separation from God. That's the result, again, for people who look at this lifestyle, look at pharmakeia, look at the use or the dealing of drugs as no big deal, the unrepentant nature of it, it doesn't end well for them, okay? It just doesn't end well for them. And so, again, that there's a lot more to it, but a lot of from here on out is kind of more abstract. But if you ever say, like, the Bible doesn't say anything about drug abuse, yes, it does. It's that word pharmakia. And the Bible's pretty stinking clear about how God sees that, okay? It's right in there with theft, with murder, with idolatry, with sexual immorality, all that stuff. It's right there in the midst of that. And so I'm going to give you three simple points. They're really not going to be profound. Also, we're going to have notes for you at the end of tonight because you asked for them 2 weeks in a row. Proud of myself. Okay. You guys ready for this? Thank you. Appreciate all the note takers in the house. Here we go. Point number one is this. Don't be an idiot. Don't be an idiot. Check this out. I want to show you what it means to not be an idiot.
What is the most inspiring thing I ever said to you?
Don't be an idiot. Changed my life. Whenever I'm about to do something, I think, would an idiot do that? And if they would, I do not do that thing.
Right? Long before Dwight Schrute gave me that awesome nugget of advice via Michael Scott, when I got saved and I gave my heart to Jesus and I started studying God's word, I would see idiots talked about a lot. It does. If you ever read the book of Proverbs, if you're ever looking to do a word study, go through the book of Proverbs. It's really short. There's 31 chapters. Read a chapter a day and get a book and highlight or underline every time it uses the word wisdom or wise and foolish, and just see which camp you want to be on. And from the very beginning, weeks and months of my Christianity, I realized very quickly, I don't want to be an idiot, okay? I had spent too much of my life being an idiot. You know what I'm talking about, right? Like, I thought I was so cool because of the stupid things I would do while I was drunk or high. And my friends glorified that. You guys see this at your school, right? Like they're talking about what happened over the weekend, what happened at the party, the thing they did that they couldn't believe that they did, like the crazy things that they do while they're not in a right frame of mind. And I didn't want to have that lifestyle anymore. I wanted to be a smart person. I wanted to be, if we had to split the entire world of the human race into smart people and dumb people, I wanted to be on the smart half. And so I started studying this stuff out. And if you don't have a Bible, I wanted to mention that a lot of us are reading our Bibles digitally, and that's awesome. I do the same. But it's really good to have a physical copy of the Bible because, like, studies will tell you time and time again, if you take notes, if you highlight, if you underline, you're going to be much more likely to retain it. And I heard something like this, is that if you have a Bible that's falling apart, it's usually a sign of a person who isn't. Okay? So that means, like, don't you have to treat it like this holy, like, book that you can't touch, like write in it, take notes, highlight it, scribble all over it, like write down the promises, personalize verses. And again, if you read through Proverbs, it's going to be very clear what wise people do and what foolish people do and what the fate is for foolish people. And I wanted to be wise people. But let me give you another verse. It's in Ephesians chapter 5. It says this. So be careful how you live. Don't live like fools, aka don't be an idiot, but live like those who are wise. Make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. See, I'd spent those years of my life when I was hooked on drugs and alcohol trying to escape the world because it was overwhelming. Again, I was depressed. I was lonely. I was all these things. And so I would use drugs and alcohol to have this temporary enjoyment. And again, like, I'm not saying I didn't have a blast. Like, the Bible says very clearly that sin is fun for a season. But it just like anything, you build up tolerance to it. It wasn't as fun as it was at first. I would have to use more to get the same experience, and it was just this downward cycle. But I, in the evil days, it was telling me very clearly, like, don't live like those. Make the most of every opportunity, because look at the world around you. Man, like, don't bury your head in the sands. We can't afford to be these people that hide in churches and put our head down and pretend like there's not this crazy world out there. We need to be aware of what's going on, and we need to live with wisdom. All right, so that's point number one. Don't be an idiot. Thank you, Dwight Schrute. Point number two is this. God calls us to be sober, to be sober. And this is the principle that really got me on, like, now I had a no. Now I knew my no. Like, now I knew why I didn't want to do drugs or alcohol. Like, I had God was, like, speaking to me, and I could feel that, and I could sense that. But this is why I knew, is when God called me to be sober, and I started studying the Word of God, and I started noticing the difference between this, like, empowerment that I felt with godly knowledge versus this, like, fake, empty empowerment that I felt when I was high. And it was very much, like, similar but different. But knowing God's Word and the strength that comes with it was so much more powerful. And so he calls us to be sober. Ephesians 5, we just read 15. Let me keep reading it. I'll read it again. Be careful how you live. Don't live like fools. But those who are wise make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Then if you keep reading, don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants you to do. And then this verse you might have heard before. Don't be drunk with wine, because that will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Okay, so it was talking about, like, just don't be an idiot. Like, this world's too crazy for you to just live your life like an idiot. In other words, if you're not making effort in life, you're probably drifting towards the idiot side, okay? Like, we can't afford to just sit on the sidelines and think it's going to just magically all work out. Like, we've got to be engaged in this battle. We talked about this last week. Like, we are in a spiritual war. And so if you're not fighting, you're getting beat up, and you might not even realize it. Again, we talked about how Satan attacks us. He doesn't attack us with a pitchfork and horns and a red face. He attacks us as the most pleasing, desirable thing you've ever experienced in your life. He comes in with temptation and lies and tricks, and that's how he gets at us. And so we can't afford to just go in there ignorant. Don't be drunk with wine, but instead be filled with the Spirit. He contrasts intense experiences with God with intense experiences with alcohol. And again, as someone who's experienced both, I can tell you what it's like to drink enough alcohol to we go from, like, drinking stuff that tastes gross to feeling a little bit warm and fuzzy to having the time of your life to puking your guts out with the worst headaches you can ever imagine. Like, I know that. But in the peak of that, it was awesome. Like, it was great, fantastic. But I can also tell you what it's like to press into God's presence and to see what it feels like to be filled with God's presence, to experience a glimpse of heaven on earth. Like the Bible says, better is one day in the presence of God than 1,000 elsewhere. And I can tell you, I've experienced that firsthand. And the presence of God is so much better. And he calls us to be sober. Let me give you one more. 1 Peter 5:8, be sober-minded. Be watchful. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And if you know this, you know, this is where you, like, you go on the, you know, the National Geographic story, you see the lion, you see how he attacks the gazelles, and, like, which gazelle is always the one that gets attacked? It's the idiot gazelle is who it is. It's when the rest of the gazelles are moving forward, and that other little idiot gazelle is, like, all by himself, being like, I've got this whole lake of water all to myself. This is fantastic, and it dips down and drinks the water, and then what happens? No more gazelle, right? It's the lonely ones. It's the ones that think they can do this world on their own. It's the ones that think they're having the time of their life, but they're all by themselves. It's the ones that fool themselves and put themselves on the outside. It's the ones that lag behind what God's called us to do. Those are the ones who get devoured. Those are the ones that the enemy can attack and take a hold of. And so let me kind of put it like this. A couple months ago, I was super duper sick. And I'll be the first to admit, I am the biggest baby when I'm sick. I am. Like, if I have a cold, I'm out. That's a wrap. I'm taking a sick day. I'm not getting out of bed. I want to sleep it off. But at night, I really hate being asleep for so many reasons, or being sick, especially when you're married, because not only is it annoying, but then now you have a spouse to annoy who gets annoyed at you for being sick. And it's not good for my marriage. And so I just cut to the chase. And I go straight to NyQuil. Not proud of it, I just do it, okay? I go straight to NyQuil, and I take enough to sleep through the night, peacefully. And there is one night, all of our bedrooms are on the second floor, and we set the alarm because we do, and we don't trust everyone. And middle of the night, and Macy, my 7-year-old, had walked downstairs while the alarm was still set. And I didn't know this at the time. All I knew was I was blissfully unaware of anything going on in the world in the middle of a NyQuil coma, and it was great. Like, not feeling or thinking anything. Deep sleep. You know what I'm talking about? Like, the kind of sleep where your chin just, like, goes into your chest. Like, that kind of sleep. Like, good, drooling on the pillow, don't care, sleep. Okay? And next thing I know, Macy is doing this blood-curdling, just top of her lungs, scream. And it wakes me up. Like, all I remember, I was dead asleep, and I, like, jumped out of bed. And because, like, I'm thinking the worst. Like, she is doing that, like, nightmarish, like, the worst has happened. She fell down the stairs. She cut, like, I, like, she must, like, sleepwalked down there. Don't have a clue. I'm thinking the worst. thinking someone broke into our house, someone's trying to steal her. Like, I'm at full-blown panic. And so I go to sprint downstairs, and Macy comes running up around the corner, but I'm in the middle of a NyQuil coma still, okay? In other words, I am not sober, okay? I am completely in a different state of mind thanks to the medicine that I was on. And I try to be there for my little 7-year-old daughter, and I just bite it. Like, I slip so far. I'm in drunken stupor. I try to grab her, but I'm falling because I'm out of my mind. And I fall back and just slip and fall, like, straight on my back. And horrible night, middle of the night. Macy sleeps with us because she's now terrified. She wakes up, and she taps me on the forehead to wake me up. She said, "Remember when Daddy fell?" That's all she remembers from that night. I'm like, what about remember when Daddy was the hero? Like, that I was going to kill whoever was down there messing with you. Like, I was trying to be the hero. All she remembers is Daddy the drunken idiot. Like, that's all she remembers. And, like, I know that's so dumb. And, like, at the end of the day, like, it wasn't that big deal. She wandered downstairs when the alarm was on and it made a loud noise. But I was in no position to protect my family. I was in no position to fight a war. I was in no position to talk clearly to anybody. Like, I was in no position to live a sober life. Anything that would have came at me would have easily taken over. And the same is true spiritually. Like, if we're not living soberly, we have flung the doors wide open to our souls. And again, I'm not here to say, like, every time you smoke drugs, like, now you're demon-possessed. That's not what I'm saying. What I am saying is, you have said, come on in, open house. I am completely okay with anyone influencing me, because I've taken substances that have altered my God-given mind, and now it's free game. And I can tell you firsthand, I'm not saying it's not spiritual, okay? Like, I believe wholeheartedly, when you open your eyes and your mind to it, you know, you hear these, like, people that love drugs, and they're like, no, man, like, you enlighten your mind. Yeah, you do. Your eyes get open that there is a spiritual world. You know how else you can do that? By reading the Bible. Like, it's all throughout there, right? Like, they're like, you won't believe the secrets of the universe, man. Like, there's this whole other world. Yeah, and you're a pawn in their game. Like, you're just being used. You're going down a path, okay? I need to move on. Okay, point number three is this. Last point. Whatever we allow to control us will. Whatever we allow to control us will. Fear, insecurity, lust, you know, attention, sports, you know, richness, fame, whatever it is. But for sure, drugs and alcohol. When you say, I want to be in a different state of mind, you are saying drugs take over, alcohol take over, whatever that looks like. I want you to take over my life, and it will. It will absolutely take over your life. And we're living in this age where, like, it's starting to get legalized and all that stuff. And, you know, they're saying, like, it's fine. It's fine. Oddly enough, those states that are starting to legalize that are seeing the fastest increase of not marijuana use, but every other drug use. Because now that that's fine and dandy, like, what else? Because they're used to that. Now they're on opioids, now they're doing cocaine, now they're doing heroin. Like, it just progresses. And so they're seeing all the rates of those kind of drugs use just go through the roof, because whatever you allow to control you, it will, every time. And I can't tell you, again, this is one of those topics where, like, but it's alcohol. A few drinks is fine. Yeah, sure, like, whatever. A few drinks, like, you make your own call on that. All I know is I've seen too many Christian friends of mine that have the call of God in their lives forfeit everything because they thought a few beers was fine. Because one day a few beers wasn't fine because they were extra stressed out or they were extra celebrating and they had that one too many. And then they made that mistake and now they don't feel like they can go back to God. And now they don't know what to do and so they keep drinking. And now alcohol becomes what their life is about. Now they don't know how to have fun without alcohol. Now they can't have a conversation with anybody else without getting buzzed. And it completely has consumed their life. And so I'm telling you, anything you allow to control your life, it absolutely will. Absolutely will. Let me give you a few more verses. Romans 6:15-16. Since God's grace has set us free from the law, So this was the big debate at this time. Again, it was about like what's legal, what's not. You know, we're not under Old Testament law. We're now living in the grace. God says we can do anything. Like we're free. We're free to live however we want. Yeah, absolutely you are. Since you're free from the law, does that mean we can go on sinning? Of course not. Don't you realize that you become a slave of whatever you choose to obey? You can do whatever you want. You are free to do whatever you want. But whatever you choose will own you. So if you let God own you, you're a slave to freedom, which isn't too bad. You let other things control you, you obey other things, you obey peer pressure, you obey what the world tells you to do, it will control you. You will be a slave to that. It will absolutely consume you. You can be a slave to sin, which leads to death, or you can choose to obey God, which leads to righteous living. One more, Hebrews 12. I love this verse. This is the one that's the motivation for me. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, in other words, the Bible says all of heaven's watching this play out. Like, they've finished their race. They're watching this war go on. They're cheering us on. Let us strip off every weight that slows us down. Again, it hasn't even talked about sin yet. It just says anything that slows you down, man, you got to get rid of it. It could be a friendship that's okay. It could be a boyfriend, a girlfriend, but it slows you down. You got to get rid of that. Like anything that slows you down, get rid of it. Anything that slows you down, especially sin that so easily trips us up. Man, it's so, like, we don't understand. We think we can play with stuff. We think we can test stuff out. We think we can, you know, get off to college and experiment. We think we can find ourselves. We think we can try this to see whether or not we like it and then make our decision from there. It says that it so easily trips us up. Let us run with endurance the race God has set out before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus. And I love this, the way that's worded. The champion who initiates and perfects our faith. In other words, it was Jesus who reached out to us and initiated faith. He gave you this glimpse of like, hey, follow me. Like, you take that leap of faith, I'm going to be right there for you. And he's also the one that perfects our faith. That when we stay attached to Jesus, he takes us down this beautiful path. That it's no longer this struggle of like, man, should I do drugs? Should I not? Like, should I go to that party and get drunk? Should I go do this and get high? Or should I spend eternity with God? Like, it's so much better. Let us run with endurance. And so here's what we're going to do. We're going to halfway close, and then I'm going to come back up. They're going to put that website up there. Go ahead and put up the capitalvhm.com if you can. The band's going to sing over you. They're going to sing this song, No Longer Slaves, like we sang earlier, because God set us free, and if we're free, we are free indeed. But we have to choose now what we're going to obey. And so they're going to sing over you. Some of you guys, like, again, there's a lot of people with a lot of different stories. Maybe that is your story. Like, maybe you are hooked on drugs or alcohol or some kind of substance, and this is like an addiction for you, and you want freedom. I want to give you a moment to just kind of have this, create your own little altar with God right where you're at, and you can repent of your sins, and you can deal with this, and I'm going to walk you through that. But maybe, again, you're here because you want to know, you want to help. Maybe you have a friend who's struggling with this, and you want to help them out. Or maybe you're in this place, and you still doubt everything I said, and that's fine. Like, we say this all the time, doubters are welcome. Like, we want your questions. So maybe you have questions, or maybe you've heard so many counter arguments against what I said, and you've got questions about that, or, you know, you're not hooked on drugs, but you're asking for a friend who's hooked on drugs. Like, whatever that is, like, I want to answer your questions, so we'll come up back in a bit. But for the next few moments, while they sing this over you, let's just make this moment, whether you say, God, all over again, I'm committing to stay sober-minded, because I don't even want to know what that world is like. I want to stay committed to you. Or maybe you need to repent. What that means is you just say, God, I'm sorry. You have to confess it. You have to acknowledge it. You can't plead not guilty and hope he gives you a pardon. You have to acknowledge your guilt. You have to face it. And you say, God, I'm sorry for fill in the blank, whatever you've done. And to renounce it means you speak against it. You say, I renounce that addiction. I speak against that addiction. I don't want that in my life anymore. And I declare that I am free from that addiction in Jesus' name. Again, some of you guys say, I don't know how to pray. Yes, you do. Just talk to God. He knows what's going on in your heart. Just talk to him about it. And we'll be back up in a few minutes. But as the band sings, come on, let's just make this a moment with God.